and welcome to this CodeBuddies.org live code hangout. By joining or scheduling a hangout, you can ask questions, work through tutorials, share ideas, or pair program on open source projects. Today we're going to be continuing working with OpenStreetMap data. We've previously created a notebook that takes a series of OpenStreetMap shapefiles and uploads them to a PostGIS database. We've got that database running in the background. And today we're going to make a couple of improvements overall to the development process and the data processing pipeline. More or less, I've added a few issues just to keep track of these ideas. We'll try to achieve as much as possible during this hangout. But essentially, we want to provide not only an easy way to spin up a PostGIS database and tear it down while preserving the data across sessions. We might as well include a nice administrative tool so the developer can interact directly with the database without having to install any other software. There's already a, this pgadmin is open source. It's already kind of packaged as a Docker container. So adding this is, I think, going to be a low-hanging fruit. Otherwise, I've been using another open source tool called dbeaver, which has packaging for Windows, Mac, and Linux. It just requires you to go to a separate download and learn how to use the interface. Any database administrative and query processing tool is going to have some learning curve. And dbeaver certainly is a good tool. The other thing we'll try to achieve, two other things, I think will be relatively straightforward, hopefully. When our pre-processing script is running, it just goes for a long time. And for example, we're loading in many different shape files, and some of them are very large. If we go back to dbeaver, we can see this table has 700,000 rows, this land use table. If I go to this OSM buildings table, switch over there, it has almost 2 million rows. And so when you're waiting for that, you know, that shape file to be processed into local RAM and then batch uploaded to Postgres, there's not much indication that anything is going on except this little asterisk over here in the JupyterLab notebook. So I believe we can add a progress indicator, and it'll just show a little bar as the thing progresses through each job. Each step of the loop, essentially that's what we're doing here, is just we're looping over an item, an iterable to list of dictionaries. And then the final thing is, once we start querying this data, which I'm hoping to do today or this weekend, we're going to want our queries to be fast. And by default, these OpenStreetMap tables, when we upload them, basically require, if you want to search for any polygon or any particular name, or even if you want to get a list of all the apartments or some other feature, Postgres has to go through every row in the table. So almost 2 million rows here to get your query result. It's called a sequential scan. And so the way to speed those up is adding indexes. So I believe we'll add a couple of indexes. I know off of hand that we're already using queries based on this feature class, actually. Maybe even the type column could be arbitrary to add, but also the geometry column is a really important one for many of our queries. Our location base, you want to find buildings around a particular location or intersection of buildings within another geometry, things like that. So those three tasks, I believe, will carry us through the session today. Spatial indexing, progress indicator, and that Docker Compose improvement. This, again, I mentioned every session is a live coding hangout. It's not a tutorial. I try to summarize these hangouts in usually around anywhere from 5 to 20 minutes at the end of the video. So if you're just watching this video on YouTube and you want to just see the summary of what we've achieved and not all the head scratching and maybe chatting on Twitch, just hop towards the end. I'll try to, I'm gonna get in the habit of throwing up this CodeBuddy screen when summarizing, although I also do this intermittently. I throw up the CodeBuddies window if I have a break or something like that. But if you look for this blue screen around the 10 minutes before the end of the video, I think that'll be a good way to jump to the TLDW section. Okay, so I'm trying to think how to approach this. This process takes 12 minutes to load all these shapefiles in, but I think if I work with a smaller sample of a couple of these smaller shapefiles, we can experiment with this progress indicator before going on to the spatial indexing step, and then maybe Docker Compose in that order seems reasonable. So that's what task we have open here. All right, so the instructions here. Oh, let me hop over to Twitch as well so I can monitor the chat. Cool. All right, it looks like it's just one pip file, or one Python module. All right, so let me just make sure I've saved the changes to our notebook. And we'll hop over to the shell. We'll stop the kernel. We're using Poetry, which is built on top of pip. And what was the name of it? IPyPB. Admittedly, I just took the first Google result here. There could be a better progress bar plugin, but this one seems pretty straightforward to add. And it might need a rebuild. There's a lot of JavaScript up front, but it doesn't seem to be too complicated, at least. All right, so now we're just going to import it. Load those dependencies. And what we're going to do is just a table map, but we're going to subset it. Let's find one of these tables that's just a few thousand rows. Something like the natural polygon in OSM places. They're pretty small. OSM's pretty small. Places of worship. Places of worship polygon. All right, so now we just have a temporary table map, and what was it called? Track. So what this is gonna do is pass it in an iterable, something that you can do something with each item in the collection, as the only argument, or first argument, maybe there's other arguments. Documentation is lacking for the rest of the. The arguments. Or is this, am I wrong here? Is this just not rendering it out? This should, I believe, render the whole docs. Let me just double check here. There's a new tool, new capability. Contextual help. Pull that to the side. It's like a help browser. When you essentially have a function, you can see the whole doc. So maybe I've just, okay. One other way I can do verify this. The alias. It's a bit confusing. Like, where is this documentation coming from? Well, that's cool. That was obviously my mistake. Here, I had clicked on the wrong method. So essentially, though, this contextual help is really useful, and the doc string omits pretty much all, only the total parameters mentioned here, so. There we go. Just a friendly reminder. I'm not like entitled to any other documentation, but it's just generally helpful. Polite and make a simple request. Okay, very cool. And I could maybe consider doing a pull request there. But honestly, I'm not totally clear. The interval is pretty obvious, but totals keep, I'm not sure what that means. Cycle, I just don't know really what these mean. Label, I think, might be the label it displays next to the progress bar. All right, cool. So now we're going to just track this. Process of opening or iterating over each of these, opening it as a geo data frame, setting the index, and then uploading it to Postgres. There we go, 2 of 2. So that's pretty good. And essentially, what we did was just replace our data. But that's a low-hanging fruit. It gives you some idea that something's going on. Let's try it with a little bit bigger of a data set. So what about this waterways? How many rows are in here? 72,000 rows. That's a little bit bigger. Let's just go ahead and do both of these. So 4 items. And it'd be interesting if we could get into this chunk size, the batch processing, but basically, if I write a loop that essentially splits out this geodata frame into batches of arbitrary size and then generates a SQL statement, then I could really get more granular with this progress indicator. But I'm just relying on this nice abstraction that GeoPandas provides recently, so I'm not going to get too complicated there. Even here, it feels kind of opaque. It's like, why is it stuck on that one? Why is step two so much slower than step one? I could print something out. Just say this step is processing, you know, 2 million rows versus this step is processing 100 rows. This is pretty cool. That's another kind of idea, is that this could run in parallel, really. We're just needing to process each of these data frames into Postgres, and there's no reason to need to run sequentially. I just don't have. Well, I have multiple cores, I just don't have like a cluster set up to run parallel processing. How would we run? Chain. Because this could be a way to. Okay, so that took 2 minutes. That's not too bad, but if we ran that in parallel, I suspect it would be much faster. And I didn't show this, but probably at any given time, we only have one CPU busy. So aside from the fact that OBS is taking CPU cycles, I guess that would be kind of hard to demonstrate here. All my CPUs are cycling. Just let me take a quick glance. Yeah, this is probably not super important right now. Okay, so we've got that low-hanging fruit out of the way. We did add a timer, a progress bar. Let's just revert this back now. Wait. One thing. I'm just going to print this step size. And not use such. This is a guess, but no. This would be a little bit more informative. Let me double check. So always in the PostGIS. Let's see if we've got a pull request for this one still. Cool. All right, so more or less we did that. Ah, forgot to upload. Okay. Yep, so we'll do spatial indexing next. However, this is a step that could take a long time. I'll have to be careful. Again, I'll work on this small sample of data. This is another thing where parallel processing would be good. So it's really the same process, just for each row, I'm going to run a SQL statement. And from what I can tell, it's just one statement, more or less. We're gonna do this in a safe manner, not just like. So we want to use this with SQL Alchemy, parameterized queries. All right, so we'll need a connection context. I don't know if I can use F strings here. No, no, it's different. It's going to use. Okay, here's what we'll do. The index name. Need the table name, the column, and then F string. This is actually where we can run these sub steps, right? It's provisional anyway. All right, so we'll import that. All right, now we want to figure out for each of these tables, we want to index the these columns, which I think they're consistent across tables. OSM buildings has geometry and F class. Let's just start there. Geometry is going to be a slow one. Let's just start with F class. Feature class there. Feature class there. F class there. Just being safe, make sure everything's good. Then we'll go to the deeper geometry one. I'll probably run that one off stream. In this follow-up stream, we're going to start querying the data. But today, I might even do two streams today. I don't know, because I'm feeling a little bit of pressure to get a demo ready for this. And this is different. Demo ready for this weekend. All right, so everybody's got a feature class. Let's just then create a list of index columns, and right now it's going to have one item. All right, we're good. Ooh. All right. And this might be redundant. All I see. Yeah, yes. So let's import this text. Then we'll set up a connection. All right, so let's get rid of that error. I guess what we're gonna do here is create our loop, which was essentially the same code as here, just for a moment, copy and pasting the whole thing. And table map temp, but instead, we're doing any of this, right? Oops. So we'll have each of the table names here. And then do some to each of those columns. Looks good. I'm printing an empty row there. Add a. I think these index types are going to be the same. I'll have to double check that. It makes sense. The spatial index. Close it. Here we are. It's the GIST. It might even have sensible defaults there. So I should actually do this. Column name, index type. All right. Equality and range operator. So F type equals, and it can be sorted in some ordering, like alphabetical ordering. It sounds like a B tree is a good one. Let's see. That right now. We're not doing full text search. So yeah, the GIST GIST index is going to be for our geometry, B tree. All right, and then what I'm unclear about is how to specify these. Just B tree all. Like this. All right, we're gonna. Now we're gonna put in these variables. We're just gonna print out the statements first, and then set up an engine and run a couple of these. So. Is there a way I can just render this out? You have to make a connection. All right. Well, let's give it a whirl. I would just like to preview this, these statements before actually setting up a connection. Ah, okay. That's what I was looking for, the params. So you can pass the params there, then check it out, then execute the query. All right? Or from statement, SQL. Wow, this is... a dense example. Bind params, maybe? Actually, that's just, what is the... It's deprecated. I don't want to execute it, I want to print it. Well, I'm not going to spin my wheels too much on this. So we've got index And then the verbose connection property. I think that was when we created the engine to make it verbose. Echo is true. All right, so basically we're passing in a dictionary. All right, so the index name, item table, okay, this is wrong. Comment. Control minus. Ooh, that's not gonna be a one. Oh, now control minus. Nope, still. Let's give us a browser and then control shift. Doesn't work on mine. Because I have an international keyboard. So it's not going to work for now. Spin back here and see. All right, makes it more clear, easier to follow. Well, let's just try this statement first and foremost. I should have done that a while ago. We're in dbeaver. Now they're using single quotes. I notice all of the properties are single quoted. Which doesn't seem like it should be the case. I wish I could just see the whole statement. Damn. What I'm guessing is that each of these is being treated as a string. And if we go back to it says it's deprecated, but I'm going to have to just use it for debugging purposes. Every step of the way, though, it's something. Some gotcha. I mean, every step of the way. These up here. I'm thinking, well, no, it's not actually going to work. I'll have to print this SQL statement. I don't know if that's mutable. Well, dang. All right. So yeah, syntax error, the same. Because the index, these SQL execution errors are just really poor, just generally in my experience. They pale in comparison with Python. I mean, geez, you'd be absolutely nothing to go by except there's a syntax error. But I believe it's because these are all quoted strings. So we're not really relying on SQL Alchemy to create our tables, to generate our tables. But this is an approach we could take, yeah. I mean, I could just go back to the F-string approach. We're not accepting any input from the end user, firstly. This is not worth fighting with SQL Alchemy to get this to work. I don't know how you can tell these parameters not to be string escaped. That's when we were using it. Colon's required, but that's different. So really, I'm just going to go to an F-string approach here. Yeah, just keep it simple. Pythonic. All right. I mean, I recognize the danger in just passing raw values into SQL statements. I don't know how to move forward without just I don't know how to get it to work without escaping those or treating them as strings, because they're table names and column names and index types. They shouldn't be string quoted. There we go. That's all I needed this whole time. And I can preview as print. So I like the power of these of SQL Alchemy and stuff, but sometimes it really it gets in the way. Dang. Whew. All right. Let's bring this back in. I think the verbose should also take care of it. Or the echo should take care of printing a SQL statement. But it was truncated and I couldn't figure out how to see the full result. Ahead of myself. All right, this is fine. So drop into the drop index if it exists. Okay, so it does run the commit, auto commit. All right, good. Whew. Man, boy, that was a challenge. All right, so we've got our indexes. Let me just take, let me clean this up just a little bit. Remove my print statement because it looks like it's printing out anyway. Verbose logging is enabled. All right. Yep, so we're creating and using the appropriate index based on the value of the dictionary. Committing that, it's fast, it's really fast. Okay, so essentially which tables do we use again? And I'm wondering if I put this in a, no, I think I'll do these steps separately. I was just wondering if I had nested dictionaries where each of the table names up here would have the index information, but I don't want to create, Yeah, I don't want to delay it too much. This already takes 12 minutes. I'll run these sequentially. Probably don't need a new connection each time. Oops, let's just see. All right, well, let's go ahead and do this for the full table map, just on, let me think here for a second. Or should we try the geometry? Let's try the geometry column and see if it adds. So 280 milliseconds for just the string, the categorical feature class column. But what's gonna look like on just two of these if we add name, geometry, and then the index type was genie? No. Just all right. Yeah, it's working in small batches before applying it on the whole data set. So again, we're only working with two tables. The OSM transport and OSM waterways table, but even though those tables have fairly sizable row counts. But now okay, so there we see we're applying the feature class and the geometry index, and it still only takes about a second. Postgres is fast. Once you get data in there in the right format, it is super fast. Let's go ahead and just for the sake of being risky, just run it on the whole table map. So we've got 18 tables here. And the buildings is one of the biggest tables. So if we hop back over here to DBeaver, whoops. And this is also running on Postgres. So it's using up all my, it's like maxing out my CPUs. Postgres is running locally, is what I'm trying to say. It's not eating too much into my RAM. And yeah, just really quick point of reference, land use and buildings are our two biggest tables. So once we get over those, most of these other ones should go fairly quick until we get to roads or water polygon. In any case, we're already at 90%. This is very reasonable time. And it takes 1 minute to create all the indexes. It takes about 12 minutes to parse all the shape files and load them into Postgres. Let's take the verbose argument off of there. All right, cool. Yo. So that's key caveat. It's a slow process. It takes quite a lot of memory resources to create these SQL statements and then transfer them. So I think this will run this process on the same machine more than likely that the Postgres instance is running, and we'll hopefully have 8 or more gigs of RAM, something like that, and a few cores. So we're gonna have to kind of price this out. Because that's just for Finland data. It took, I think, 4 gigabytes of RAM and over 12 minutes. Yeah, just doing work on my local machine. This is fast here because I've commented everything out. Sorry, what are we using? SQL Alchemy. Well, it doesn't really matter. All right. And I'll print the. It'd be nice to show just a little bit of animation here, a little movement. It's just a small touch, but it could matter. I believe, let's see, Jupyter Lab emoji. I don't know if this is a good idea. Yeah, this is probably a bad idea anyway. Alright, it takes a little over a minute. So, alright, we're good to go. We'll go ahead and commit this. Because I think the main thing is the throbber would be displaying on all of these. It might be good to replace that text instead of having a growing line of it. It would just replace it each time. I could learn this real quick. And then the throbber would make sense. This would be pretty cool. See if it works. I don't know if I need to install this. Or just import it. Makes sense. Let me commit this before I get anything more fancy in there. And this is superfluous because I think this script's going to be running in like a command line anyway, but all right. I'll give it a try. It doesn't hurt to learn things, and it kind of might be a little fun aside, and then we'll be able to spend a little bit of time, hopefully, in getting this Docker Compose file going. Just a quick detour to IPython widgets. Okay. The key question is, does this work in every stage of a loop? Or will it just append to it? Oh well, not a big deal. I thought it would just work more simply than that. Essentially by calling it, but this just appends a list, appends them to the list. And it's not even working. All right, it's just superfluous, as I was mentioning earlier. Right back. Excellent. All right, we're just going to go ahead and save these changes and commit it. Just scan it one more time. We're going to remove or revert the poetry. DiPy notebooks, DiPy widgets. We're not really going to use them. Those we can explore another time, just to add some interactivity to the notebooks. But yeah, again, this code is targeting server automated scripts, so there's a little bit of a detour, honestly. All right, cool. And the last thing I'd like to try is to get pgAdmin running. This was useful though. This has been pretty good progress. Yes, more or less we can now stop the server, the Jupyter notebook server, and we're gonna just kind of crib some code. Well, this is essentially, we're going to be updating this Docker Compose file. And running that again. I don't know if I need to necessarily drop the whole database. This located. I'm going to check if this is relative. This slash is relative to the. Oops, that's not what I wanted to open. Gosh. I open my file browser. So here's our Docker Compose. We can see the data is not being stored there. I run the Docker Compose from here. That's really strange. What does this mean? Let's see, where does Docker Compose create its volumes? It's not super urgent, but that's interesting. So this is probably the internal, and this is maybe local. See if everything is if it's still running. All right, so this is one thing I don't want it to restart. Tabs open. Yeah, so it is running, even though I closed the terminal. Now, it's ready to accept. I can check some stuff out. When I stop the server, I like YAML because you can put comments in there. JSON, you can't. It's kind of annoying. Okay, the server times out then. I'll just comment it out, leave it in. I know it's a bad habit, and I don't typically try to do that. This is a development environment. I'm just going to delete it. All right, so we're still in the same branch. I'm just kind of doing a lot with this pull request. Now we're going to read through this. So that makes it a little bit more sense. I still don't know where Postgres is keeping the storage. I think you might specify a location here. Ah, okay, so, sorry, that's under the services. I was doing that wrong. This way it's obvious where the Postgres data is, so a developer can also clean up their environment. I think this is important because we're dealing with a lot of data here. This is the problem. It's actually highlighting it for me. Let me know. That's good. This is pretty. Man. It's fairly opaque. All right. Let's take a look. There we have Postgres data folder. Yes. We'll add that to our gitignore. Which means our database system is now been reset, more or less. Let's go ahead and see if I can reconnect here. Refresh the connection. Public tables. We should have no tables. All right.
Wait a minute.
Might have to remove it.
Just removing containers.
All right, this is similar command docker system. Just gonna clean everything up. I'm gonna refresh the image. I just wanna make sure that the Postgres data is being stored to this volume. I'm not sure within the image where the Postgres data is stored. Okay, now we're just going to connect again with DBeaver. Refresh the connection. And we'll check our file system, or I think I can do that just with VS Code. Let's go ahead and this is not going to work anyway because I didn't run about all of them. But what I'm after is to see, firstly, did the data get created? We have a new table there. Secondly, did it get created on our file system? Okay. All right, so we'll fix this. Otherwise, the volume's not important. Maybe it's just not important. could be just a simplification if we just I'll do is I'll just see if the data are persisted across sessions this way without specifying a volume. The volume would be good for the Django project because we want to work with the local code, but it doesn't seem like Postgres is actually storing its data in that location internally, so it doesn't mean it's not meaningful to have a mapping to a local directory. Index is not important. Rows, then we will stop Postgres. Just double check. Run Postgres. Yeah, so it keeps the data. The whole point of this volumes setting, I guess, was just so we would have a shared directory. I don't think it's important. Not right now. Cool, now let's do the fun part. More or less closing this. 15. Excellent. All right. So giving it a name, I think, is a good idea. We don't have a name right now, so we'll get container name. Maybe this will work yet. So we're going to want it to connect. To pgAdmin. And pgAdmin shouldn't really run. I essentially want the map, I don't want it to map to port 80 because we might be running something else on port 80 eventually. See if this works. Hopefully we have 50-50. No, it's mapping to 80. Dang it. All right, let's try the Postgres connection again. All right. And the password changed, so I need to view the database. And it's good. How do I change the credentials? Excellent. Now, got lots of output from there, but why? Don't we have anything from the pgAdmin? What I noticed in the logs was that it says it's listening on port 80. Let's check the documentation for this image. Maybe it needs HTTPS. be consistent, have the environment variables follow the documentation. Defaulting to 80. We'll see if this 80 works. Looks like it. Nice. Okay. That would be nice if the server would be pre-configured also. That would be just icing on the cake. Let me see if I can figure that out. First, we'll commit these changes. I again think these volumes are maybe not so important. Let me double check the volume. If there's any data in the pgAdmin data directory, I don't think so. I'm gonna take a quick break. And then we'll come back and we'll commit these changes. We'll see if we can do one last thing to auto-configure the server address, because we know things are pretty much going to work consistently here. Yeah, see if I can pass those in as configuration parameters. All right, cool. I'll be right back. Alright, thanks for bearing with me. Yeah, so I'll just read either the pgAdmin docs or this container deployment docs to see if there's a way we can specify the configuration. Servers JSON looks like a promising one. Problem is, if it's a little bit brittle, try it. It'd be really cool if I could just specify that configuration as a JSON variable, but all right, this is not too bad. Because if somebody overrides these variables, the JSON's going to be brittle. If I could just specify it inside of the container configuration with these same, or maybe even a global, some outside a global variable up here that is the same thing. Just JSON files are static, so I don't know how I'd be able to get these environment variables out. and that's the default server that it runs on. So let me think here. So we have pgadmin for service JSON. So pgadmin for should be the directory. And it'll map to pgadmin data. And I'll put a service JSON in there. And then what does that look like? Okay. It's not even worth it. Put it in a README. Simplest solution. Just add it to the docs. This actually works. There is Postgres data here. It's just only accessible to my root user. and check the ownership, but just check that ownership now. Systemd core dump. Alright, I've got everything back to normal. I'm going to just try without these volumes to see if this stuff is persistent. I just don't understand how really Docker works on so many levels. A little bit different. for tables, here we go. Yeah, we have the special reference system. I mean, certainly people can use DBeaver and other database clients. Takes some getting used to, but okay. Now the main question is, will it persist the data even though I've removed those volumes? Pretty much. Very cool, a little bit of information overload here, but it's a good way of learning the intricacies of Postgres. So what do we do? I'll revert this change. We will commit this. This is a really good stopping point. Very good progress. Push these changes up. Very good. Just after three hours. We'll add some documentation. it's always important to get a little bit of developer documentation. I hope this documentation is in general useful, but I don't know. There's always snags. Very cool. Okay. Let me just get everything ready. Hold on, our Jupyter Notebook. I'm going to do a summary. I wish this would just, on my local terminal, I can right click and say copy link as, but there's no option here. And highlight it and hit Control Shift C. Because this Chromium's not my default browser, but in any case, not a big deal. Hello and welcome to this recap of today's CodeBuddies.org live code hangout. Today we've kind of checked off a few items on our to-do list, some things that came to mind. We've got a pull request in progress, number 115. We've been working on it for a couple of days, and it essentially involves having a local PostGIS instance up and running and making it really easy for other developers to spin up a PostGIS instance and tear it down when they're done developing for the day, mainly for myself, but if anybody else gets involved with the project, as well as having a PG admin utility. I'm not sure the scope of PG admin is very capable though, including monitoring your database and running queries. So I just thought the combination of Postgres and PostGIS ready-made server and pgAdmin would be improving the developer experience for this project. And also worked on a follow-up to the OSM to PostGIS importer script. The script previously takes a bunch of shapefiles and writes them to PostGIS tables, and that works fine. But when we query those tables, the queries would be very slow because there's no database indexing. So it has to scan every row in the table in order to find the information we're after. And really, we're querying quite a lot on feature class, the OSM feature class, as well as these geometries, for example, finding overlaps or proximity. So what I did today is the bottom half of this notebook to add indexes. I'll just go through the whole notebook for context. It's not very big, and then we'll just take a look at the Docker Compose file for how we are running PostGIS and pgAdmin with a single command. So this OpenStreetMap to PostGIS notebook, it relies on GeoPandas and SQL Alchemy mainly. I also added a progress bar to give some feedback because the processes in this notebook are pretty slow. The data are very large and take a while to upload. So we connect to our database instance. It's running locally in the Docker Compose file. Then we have a series of shapefiles I downloaded from GeoFabric. And for each of those, I want to kind of upload it to a specific table. So I'm just specifying that here, so it's explicit, it's obvious, and gives us the option to override those. So we have this whole mapping of shapefiles to databases. then we parse all those, since we, I've got a little bit of an error here. I work on temporary, since I don't want to work on this whole data set, it wants to run quick experiments, so I create temporary variables, but in any case, I forgot to clean that up. For each of those items in the table map, these dictionaries, we're going to open it as a GeoPandas GeoData frame. We're going to set the OpenStreetMap identifier as the index. I believe that carries through to the database data. I'll have to double check that off stream, because this should preserve the index. And we just essentially want to give the end user an idea that something's going on. So we'll print out the number of rows that this step is processing, so they have an idea of the scope of this step. And then upload that to PostGIS. Now, if you notice here, this is a standard Python 4 item in iterable loop. But we're actually, our iterable is this a helper function from the IPy progress bar package. And what it does essentially is just tracks the progress and displays this progress bar down here of how many steps there are. Now in our temporary table map, I just used two of those shapefiles, but there's something like 18 shapefiles here. So you would at least see, you know, like 60% progress through these. And for each of the rows, you get a row count, so you get an idea of how long that step might take. And at the end of the session, end of the process, you have a wall time of how long it took. I might even print out the timing of each of the steps. We're just trying to give the people feedback rather than just a small asterisk there indicating progress. So most of this code was already working yesterday, but just for context, that's it, how we're getting the data into PostGIS. And really, adding indexes is almost the same process. I created another dictionary mapping dictionaries. But this one, these are the columns. Luckily, the GeoFabric data there consists in all of the data frames, and all of the tables subsequently have the same column structure. We know the feature class is important because we're doing subsetting the OpenStreetMap data, like asking for places of worship or hospitals or supermarkets and things like that. And that information is in the feature class, or the F class column. And we're using just a standard B-tree index, which would have been by default, but for our code to be more generic, I just made it explicit here. And for the geometry column, we're using a gist index. So that lets you do kind of bounding box queries and then more refined queries inside those bounding boxes. It's like a hierarchical tree of bounding boxes or something in my basic understanding. The main difference in this code is we're actually using our SQL Alchemy engine. We're creating a temporary connection. And for each of those tables, again, we're going to look at the essentially details of that table. I'm cleaning up as I go. We want to get the table name for that item. And essentially, we're going to iterate over those index columns, because again, each of the tables has the same structure. So, for each of the tables, we're going to iterate over the index columns, and we're going to make an index for each of those columns and then go into the next table. So inside of the loop here, we're creating an index name, and by convention, it's essentially the name of the table, an underscore, the name of the column, an underscore, and IDX for index. I'm just following that convention. I'm just using Python fstring here to create that. And it's printing down here below to give the progress update. We're creating OSM buildings, F class, index, and then OSM buildings, geometry index. So you can see our column F class and our column geometry listed here, as well as progress going through all 18 of those tables. This whole process is much faster than the managing of the data and uploading the data. The uploading of the shape files and processing those in batches takes about 12 minutes for all of Finland, and then the running of these indexes takes just over a minute. But so let's go ahead and just check out the rest of this. What we're doing is just preparing a SQL statement. I tried using, you know, to avoid potential SQL injection or some kind of bad practice. I tried using SQL Alchemy prepared statements for this. I just couldn't get it to work. It took like I had 30 minutes to just say, hey, I'm gonna go back to F strings here. Because really all we need is just first check if the index exists, because we might be running this on data that already exists. Hey, Imperium, welcome. I'm just doing a summary of today's session, but I will be kind of streaming a little bit later, but it's nice to see a familiar face. So this SQL statement, first it checks the for the existing index and then creates it. So we're just using that index name variable. We're telling it what table to create the index on, what index type to use, and the column to use, the column to make to index, essentially. Then with that connection, we're executing the SQL statement. The code is, you know, fairly clean, and I think will be easy to maintain and understand later if I come back to it. You know, it would be nice to use those prepared statements instead of F strings, but I think since this is kind of not really expecting end user input or something like that, and we're just using this to more or less kind of cache the OpenStreetMap data into PostGIS for querying and geoprocessing, making derived geoprocesses. I think it's relatively okay to use these F strings. Do I know how to hack? Yes, I think my hacking style is to kind of figure things out slowly, avoid pulling my hair out or like crying out of frustration. And just try things over the course of time from different angles until I kind of get something working and get to a stopping point. I know that's not the conventional definition of hacking, but my understanding of hacking is it's another way of being creative, like making music or art or something like that. You're just figuring stuff out, you're making something, yeah, probably sharing your work, or baking is another example. In the kitchen, you have lots of interesting experiments, and eventually they might be yummy enough to share. So we're hoping that soon this project will be pretty close. I'm going to try to have a prototype this weekend for the end-to-end deal. I've just got to get this data processing out of the way, so to speak, getting the data into PostGIS so we can query it from Django and then send it to a JavaScript client. So that said, let's just take a look. Just pgadmin's running. This is really cool, really powerful server PostgreSQL server administration tool. I'm not that familiar with it, but you can run queries from here. You can check your schemas. You can make sure things are indexed. You can check your triggers and PostgreSQL extensions. You can see we've got our PostgreSQL extension installed. It's really cool. And I thought having that by default for new developers would be a useful feature. So the main thing here, as we've made changes to the Docker compose file, so our PostgreSQL server service, we just gave it a name so that you get nice printouts when you're starting up, and you can. So here's pgadmin and PostgreSQL printing stuff out. We're not really changing anything else here, except where PostgreSQL stores its data, and I've removed the volumes from both of these. I don't know the use of volumes. They seem to store the data across sessions. If I tear down this Docker compose, and the services stop running, when I spin them back up, the data is still there. So I think the volumes are mainly for mapping local directories into your image if you need somehow having a shared file system. If I'm wrong on that, I will put the volumes back. Then we create a little network so that the pgadmin can have visibility into this PostgreSQL service and give it a name, tell it which image to use, and specify some configuration parameters with default values. I didn't know you could do that. Learned how to do that today, as well as specifying the port. I think we'll let it run on port 80 and connecting to the network, which is bridged over into, I don't know, it's just bridging between the two of those, I guess. Yeah, cool. I mean, coding is hacking, and I think hacking comes from the sound it makes when you type on a keyboard. It's just a way of being creative. Just like, you could call playing your guitar strumming, or something like that, or noodling is another kind of way. That's how I play guitar, as I noodle. So I think that's about it, and thank you for the segue. The pull request here is number 115. And as Imperium 42 mentions, if you're interested in getting more focused on coding and involving yourself in some open source projects and getting around like-minded people, stop by codebuddies.org. CodeBuddies is a great community. There's lots of groups forming about around almost any kind of technology or sort of different concepts like data science and things like that, so higher level practices that involve technology. CodeBuddies is also an open source project on GitHub at github.com/codebuddies. If you'd like to get involved with this sustainable urban design project, stop by github.com/sustainableurbandesign. In any case, it's been nice to see you, Imperium. Thanks for stopping in. I'll try to stream a little bit later tonight. I just need a break to decompress and think about the next steps for the project. So I hope you all are doing well out there, and that you stay healthy, keep on social distancing, and have a great day. Peace.